Will our knowledge of the universe be changed forever? Renowned theoretical physicist Michio Kaku recently reported a startling discovery uncovered by NASA's James Webb multi-billion-dollar telescope, which discovered six huge galaxies, each approximately the size of our Milky Way. A set of galaxies from the beginning of the universe that are so massive they shouldn't exist. The six massive galaxies contain nearly as many stars as the Milky Way despite having formed only 500 to 700 million years after the Big Bang. They have been dubbed the universe breakers by the astronomers who discovered them because if they are real, the discovery calls our entire understanding of galaxy formation into question. It is unlikely that the early universe could have organized itself that quickly. Theoretically, these galaxies should not have had time to form. Erica Nelson, assistant professor of astrophysics at the University of Colorado Boulder and one of the researchers who contributed to the discovery, said in a statement that scientists don't know exactly when the first star clusters began to combine into the beginnings of the galaxies we see today. Cosmologists previously assumed that the process began to take shape gradually in the first 100 million years following the Big Bang. According to current beliefs, these early protogalaxies reached adolescence 1 to 2 billion years into the universe's lifespan, generating galaxies that began to consume each other to grow into ones like our Milky Way. Because light moves at a constant speed across the vacuum, the deeper we delve into the universe, the more distant light we can intercept and the further back in time we can observe. Using the James Webb Space Telescope to look back 13.5 billion years, astronomers discovered that massive galaxies had already burst into existence very shortly after the Big Bang, when the universe was barely 3% its current size. This requires us to reassess all we know. Galaxies are so enormous that they contradict 99% of cosmological ideas. This means that either our models must be updated, or the scientific understanding of galaxy formation must be rethought. In any case, James Webb made a stunning discovery. Each year, the Milky Way generates 1 to 2 new stars. For the whole course of the universe, these galaxies are predicted to produce hundreds of new stars per year. If even one of these galaxies is true, we will have reached the limits of our cosmological understanding. All the evidence now points to these celestial objects being galaxies. However, scientists have not ruled out the possibility that some of them are gigantic quasars or supermassive black holes. Regardless, the new mass means that the known mass of stars during this age of our universe is up to 100 times more than previously imagined. The huge galaxies were not identified in previous Hubble Space Telescope photographs of the early universe, but JWST is about 100 times more powerful than Hubble. But exactly how do we understand how far these objects really are and therefore what age are they? And is it true how do you hear somewhere that Webb has demonstrated that the Big Bang model is in crisis or that it doesn't work? When I look far away, I also look back in time. It simply means that when I look far away, the light that reaches me from those distant regions had to travel to cover the distance, so it took a certain time to reach me. So, I'm not really looking at the object as it is now, so to speak, but I'm looking at it as it was when the light went on. So in fact telescopes are time machines. We can literally look at how the universe was in the past by simply looking far into space, and this thing helps us understand what the history of the universe was. But going into more detail, when I look at a distant object, how do I understand the distance and therefore the age it was when the light went out? The way we use, especially for very distant objects, is to measure a very special parameter called redshift. What is redshift? Where does the redshift come out? The universe expands and the expansion stretches all distances, therefore it also stretches and dilates the wavelength of light. Therefore, over time that light does take to reach me from a distant object up to today, its length wavelength is stretched by the expansion of the universe. So a wavelength that it originally had a certain value today, we receive it move towards the red, i.e. towards longer wavelengths in the electromagnetic spectrum. To be precise, redshift in astronomy is measured with a value which is denoted by z with the letter z and the wavelength, therefore, undergoes one redshift and comes multiplied by a factor of 1 plus z. So, if the redshift is 0 z equal to 0, the wavelength is not changed because you have to multiply it by 1. If the redshift is greater than 0, the wavelength undergoes a dilation and therefore a redshift, which grows as 1 plus z. So, if I look at a distant object, a distant galaxy, the light of that galaxy will have undergone a redshift that is all the greater the further away the galaxy is. If I measure the redshift using physical and mathematical models, I can trace the distance of the object and also the age of the object, i.e. I can figuring out when the light went on from the object I'm observing. Webb is a possible source of confusion here. An object with a large redshift is an old object in the sense that its light left a long time ago, but in reality, I look at it as it was when he was young. It is like saying I get a picture of a person who is 90 today, but that photo has been taken when that person was only 1 year old. Then in the photo, I see it as it was when he was 1 year old. What is the most distant thing we can observe in the universe? It is not an object but the universe itself. The fact is that in the past the whole universe was filled with a gas of incandescent particles. So all the universe shone, if I look far enough I can see this post-Big Bang glow which is called cosmic radiation background. This cosmic background radiation that comes to me from all space directions if I look with the right tools, it has a lot of redshift. It has been evaluated equal to 1000. How much corresponds to a redshift of 1000? Corresponds to a universe age of about 380,000 years, therefore this background radiation that I received today with a redshift equal to 1000, i.e. its wavelength has been dilated by a factor of 1000. The universe had only 380,000 years of this cosmic microwave background, we have observed it. There is no doubt that this is the case and what happened next after. For some time there was this incandescent gas in the universe but there weren't any stars, any galaxies because they had not yet had time to form and this period that lasted we don't know exactly how long. But a few hundred million years we call it the Dark Age because it wasn't there yet no light there were no stars there were no galaxies. James Webb was built precisely to investigate, to better study this Dark Age because there, if there were stars or galaxies, their light reaches us. Even if it's very weak because they are very far away and then with a lot of redshifts. So there is a need for a specific telescope for that type of infrared wavelengths where the light should have been moved. Okay, having said that, how do you measure redshift? How do we know which one it is redshift? Well, ideally the most accurate method is to take a spectrum of the object that is to know that there are lines in the spectrum electromagnetic field of this object that correspond to the lines that I can study in the laboratory whose frequency and length I know exactly. Therefore, when I observe them in a distant object by comparing the position of the lines with the position of the lines that I observe in the laboratory, I can figure out how much they have been shifted. So what is the redshift? This is the ideal method. It is the most accurate method, but it may not always be used because it takes time to take the spectrum of an object. The observation time is precious, especially in an instrument that must observe many objects, many things, many galaxies, and therefore often to shorten the time you use an alternative method. Technically, this method alternative is called photometric redshift to distinguish it from the spectroscopic one. To simplify, we could say that this type of redshift is not measured by observing the displacement of lines in the electromagnetic spectrum that we know, but by simply observing an image of the object. Assuming that if we know what should be the color of this object, how much it is reddened, how much it is moved towards the red, we can figure out how much the redshift is. I'm simplifying a lot, but for understand each other, if they give me a photograph of an apple and I know that the apple must be yellow. They see in the photograph that it is red and I understand that it has been redshifted by redshift. This method, though it also involves possible errors to remain for example of the apple, maybe that the apple is not yellow and has turned red due to the redshift, but that it is red precisely because it is a red apple. Of course, it is only an analogy, is only an example. However, there are cases which make photometric redshift very useful, when we know the object well. Therefore, this thing allows us to determine the composition even without making a spectrum, but it becomes more uncertain in some cases, especially in the case of the Webb Space Telescope. When we look very far and therefore look at objects that we have probably never seen first in that form, then in general the photometric redshift is okay to do an initial survey to look for candidates who, however, must always be studied better and confirmed by making real redshifts with spectrum measurement. Doing this, maybe there realizes the redshift that was attributed to that object initially it's wrong. For example, recently there had been a candidate for a possible galaxy at a very high redshift of 16. It would be truly very large. But when the spectroscopic redshift is done, it has been discovered that it was actually a galaxy that stood with a lot more small redshift of 4.9. But Webb has already had time to measure the spectrum of some galaxies. Therefore, in this case, we know with great precision what is the redshift of these objects. Just recently, Webb precisely measured the redshift of some galaxies using spectrum and found that the redshift is between 10 and 13, which corresponds to an age of the universe between 300 and 500 million years. The question we could ask ourselves is how these galaxies did to form so quickly in such a short time after the Big Bang. This such a short time is something that throws the Big Bang model into crisis. Well, meanwhile, let's say that the very fact that we are interpreting the distance and age of these galaxies through redshifts tells us that we are using the Big Bang model to make this interpretation. So it would be contradictory to say that through these observations we have proved that the Big Bang is false. Not only are there no reasons to think that the Big Bang model is completely wrong, but as I said, the fact that we observe the background radiation which has a redshift 1000 is overwhelming evidence that the Big Bang model works. A different thing, however, is wondering if the galaxy formation models within the Big Bang model succeed. Actually, to explain such a rapid appearance of galaxies in a few hundred million years after the Big Bang, an open field of research is still being actively investigated, and there is undoubtedly still a lot to understand. A few months ago, there was a study published in Nature using Webb data showed the possibility that there were six galaxies that already had a mass similar to that of our Milky Way when the universe was just 600 million years. After this observation, there have been many headlines. There has been much talk of the fact that this discovery would have broken the Big Bang model, but things are not quite like this. If indeed these galaxies were confirmed to be as distant and as large as they appear to be, obviously, we would have to review the models of the formation of galaxies. There would be some things that need to be better understood, which clearly escape us right now, but it would not be a matter of abandoning the Big Bang model for this. But the thing that needs to be emphasized is that these six galaxies which have been talked about so much as the galaxies would have broken the Big Bang model are galaxies that are still simply candidates. The photometric redshift, i.e. the one based on images, exists only for the moment, and we do not yet have a spectroscopic redshift. Certainly, further investigations will be carried out in the coming months, so we have to wait to understand if this observed receipt will be confirmed. Then the final message of all this is that we must be happy because Webb has pushed the observations where no one had ever gone before. Now we can look at the universe and the objects that were in the universe when it was only 300 million years old, so Webb it's doing exactly what it was built for. The message, however, is that one must not always draw hasty or sensationalized conclusions whenever it comes made the announcement of a new potential discovery. Every time there is someone who has a great rush to say that the Big Bang model doesn't work or that it has been put in crisis. But things are not like that in reality. The community of astrophysicists thinks that the model of the Big Bang overall is doing great. We certainly haven't yet got it all figured out. There are still many things we need to discover, but as usual with patience, we will try to understand.